When I was in graduate school at the University of Minnesota in the geology department, my wife, now my ex-wife, Kathy, was in the history department there. As part of her coursework, she had to take a course where each of the faculty gave a talk and assigned a book. It was called the Dog and Pony Show, as each professor trotted out their favorite book and talk. Now, she was a medieval historian and had little interest in science, but one of the professors was into the history of science and assigned a book called The Structure of Scientific Revolutions by Thomas Kuhn. She read it and thought it was the dumbest book she ever read. Well, since I was interested in science, I read the book too. It was one of the most brilliant books I've ever read. Kuhn says that the way scientific revolutions happen is by something called a paradigm shift. A paradigm is a distinct set of concepts or thought patterns, including theories, research methods, postulates, and standards for what constitutes legitimate contributions to a field, according to Kuhn. A paradigm continues to function until anomalies that cannot be explained using the paradigm emerge. Eventually, the paradigm will be abandoned as a new paradigm comes into acceptance. This is called a paradigm shift. That term, paradigm shift, is now used for many things outside of science, like the shift from most people smoking to smoking being more rare. The story of plate tectonics is the story of a paradigm shift. And the story begins with a scientist called Alfred Wegener. Alfred Wegener was a German meteorologist. In 1910, he was at a Christmas party, and a friend had received a new atlas. As Wegener paged through it, he observed the obvious correlation between the shape of the east coast of South America and the west coast of Africa. This led him to propose that all the continents had once been together as a supercontinent, which he called Pangaea, which means all lands. He eventually published this in a book called The Origin of Continents and Oceans, published in 1915. For this class, you need to know what his theory was and what evidence he presented. He stated that prior to about 200 million years ago, there existed a supercontinent that encompassed all the current continents, and that this supercontinent broke up and the continents drifted over the ocean floor to their current positions. Note that this was not the first supercontinent. The continents have assembled and broken up several times over the history of the world. This is just the most recent one. It's pretty clear that the continents fit together well, like a jigsaw puzzle or a broken china plate. The fit was even better when he used the edge of the continental shelves instead of the shorelines. So this was evidence number one. He also looked at the fossils that had been found on the disparate continents. Up until 200 million years ago, they were very similar. But after that, they diverged. This is because when the continents broke up, the animals evolved along different paths. A good example is the Glossopteris. This is a plant fossil, and it is found in rocks that are about 275 million years old. It is found on all the southern continents, including Antarctica. Another line of evidence had to do with glaciers. The current glacial age is not the first time this has happened in Earth history. There were other periods when large continental-scale glaciers advanced across the land. About 300 million years ago, glaciers moved across the southern part of Pangaea, leaving behind glacial deposits. Glacial striations, like those shown here, are scratches on the rocks that show the direction of movement. But these make no sense with the current configuration of the continents. It would seem to have glaciers moving from ocean to the land, and it would have glaciers in places that cannot have glaciers now, such as Australia or India. Those places are too close to the equator, too hot. But according to Wegener, they were closer to the South Pole at the time the glaciers existed and have now drifted to warmer climates. When you put the continents back into the Pangaea arrangement, it all makes sense. The glaciers spread out from the South Pole across Pangaea. The directions of movement make more sense this way. Also, some other climate evidence was used. For example, there are deposits of coal in Spitsbergen. Spitsbergen is the island that is in the middle of this image, and it's in the far north and very cold. But we know that coal forms in swamps in warm areas. When those coal deposits formed, Spitsbergen was in a more equatorial location. Over millions of years, it drifted north to its present cold location. There's also evidence from mountain ranges. The Appalachian Mountains and the Caledonian Mountains in Europe are the same age and same type of mountains. If you put Pangaea back together, they match up. They're really the same mountains. They split apart when Europe and North America broke up. In fact, there are places where the rock layers on one side of the ocean match up very well with the same sequences of beds on the opposite side. Wegener said it was as if you were to fit the torn pieces of a newspaper back together, and if the lines of print read across, then they must have been connected. But in the 1920s, the paradigm in existence was not sufficiently challenged to make most scientists abandon it. Wegener's ideas were rejected. There were alternate explanations for much of the evidence he put forward. Animals and plants might have crossed the ocean on rafts of floating vegetation. This happens. Or they might have crossed via land bridges like exist now between North America and Asia or North and South America. Or hopped from island to island. The fit of the continents was good, but not perfect. Some of the evidence was rejected as coincidental. And since much of the evidence was in the southern hemisphere, but most geologists were working in North America and Europe, they didn't catch on very well. Also, Wegener could provide no good explanation of the mechanism of continental drift. He called on centrifugal forces from the spin of the Earth, or the tidal drag of the moon and sun. These forces are too weak to cause continents to move. And his vision of continents plowing through the ocean basins was not quite correct, as we shall see. Wegener died in 1930 while in Greenland on an expedition, and without the champion of continental drift, it went on the back burner for a few decades.